Hachette Audio presents Electronically Yours, Volume 1, My Autobiography, written by Martyn Ware and read by the author. To my mum and dad, Kitty and Jack, for all your love and sacrifices. To my sisters, Maureen and Janet, thanks for my childhood musical inspiration. To my brother Steve, 1948 to 2020, my hero and my role model. Rest in peace. But most of all, to Lansley, Eleanor and Gabriel, I do it all for you. Take a deep breath. Calm down. Okay, what on earth am I doing here? A nervous, underqualified, musically self-taught young lad from a very poor, working-class steelworkers family, bluffing my way in the very frightening, very dangerous, but exciting music business. No manager, no business experience, but still hoping to make it big one day. And this is definitely as big as it gets. Well, be careful what you wish for. My head is exploding. On the one hand, Tina, international superstar with decades of experience on TV shows, live and in the studio. On the other, a rookie producer with very limited TV experience, singing backing vocals live on TV for the first time ever for anyone. It's 1983 and we're sitting in the cramped dressing room at the nation's hottest music TV show, The Tube. It is 20 minutes before transmission time and Glenn and I have just polished off 2 pints of lager each in a futile effort to stifle the mounting panic of appearing live on national television with one of rock's greatest living legends, Tina Turner. The single I produced for her, a cover version of Al Green's Let's Stay Together, is starting to break out, and this TV appearance is to be the booster rocket to send sales into the stratosphere. As we are changing into our Burton suits, with our trousers round our ankles, in walks Tina, unannounced, with her two backing singer dancers, Anne Beringer and Lejeune Richardson. We quickly make ourselves decent, zipping up our flies, as Tina makes an announcement in her mezzo growl. Hi boys, we've had an idea for the show. This isn't helping our nerves at all. Okay Tina, what is it? I stutteringly reply. Anne is blonde, so Anne, you should stand with Glenn. Lejeune, you will stand with Martyn. Sounds good to me, I reply. Then, when the middle eight arrives, we need to spice it up for the cameras, Tina mysteriously teases. I think, what does she mean? Anne and Lejeune will kneel down at your feet and run their hands up and down your legs and bodies. Tina seems quite insistent. Pretty standard procedure in the world of Las Vegas Showtime, it would appear. Terrified, I look at Glenn, whose mind I can read, and immediately retort, I don't think that's a very good idea, Tina. We might get a little, overexcited. This is the most delicate way I can put our concerns. The potential for mortal embarrassment in full world view is just too big a risk to take. There is an uneasy pause, then Tina laughs and very kindly withdraws the offer, thank the Lord, but we are both still concerned that Anne and Lejeune might do it anyway, just out of a sense of mischief. On stage, they don't, but the fear that some of the showgirl moves are about to be put on us just make us even more nervous, which you can clearly witness on YouTube. Also, I'm used to having a keyboard as a prop. What the hell do you do with your hands when you're singing? They feel like cartoon appendages flapping around. Do I dance? Does Lejeune want to dance with me? A million thoughts go through my exploding mind. Two Sheffield electro soul boys in suits, awkwardly juxtaposed with Tina and her dancers, dressed in Flintstones outfits. Are we cool? Or are they cool and we're too straight? God knows. As Tina introduces us on stage, she refers to us as her producers. That sounds very flattering and grown up, but inside my head it's a different story. I am having an out-of-body experience floating above the stage, looking at my awkwardness. How did I get here? Am I worthy of such attention? I don't feel like a pop star. I feel like an imposter. Shut the fuck up, Martyn, and be grateful for God's sake. Well, we managed to get through the song without too much embarrassment. Even though I missed my first cue and Lejeune, who was part of the original Iquettes, gave me a look that said, Jesus, who is this jerk? We relaxed a little into the song as it rapidly became obvious that Tina was the only person on stage that the audience was interested in. She was magnetic and magnificent. As the song thankfully ended and the writer's applause started, we even took a linked arm bow. Of course, I panicked and gave Tina a peck on the cheek, which seemed to surprise her. God, what was I thinking? But then it was over. The relief was immense and the feedback was overwhelmingly positive. The biggest public test of our careers had been a triumph. What's more, we had a major worldwide hit in our hands. The performance had worked its magic. The single shot up the charts around the world, and in the US, the record was becoming a hit in the clubs and on the radio. Amazingly, Let's Stay Together soon became the biggest selling maxi single in US Billboard chart history. Tina's career had officially been relaunched, and my career as an internationally in-demand producer seemed to be guaranteed. I had no idea where the ship was going, but I was definitely the captain, full of youthful confidence and optimism, except for the occasional wobble, of course. Anything seemed possible, or even probable. That was 1983, the year of Band-Aid, and Hem 17 and my production identity, British Electric Foundation, BEF, were both blossoming. Bob Last, who had originally signed my previous band, The Humerly, to Fast Records, and then got us a deal with Virgin Records, had been managing Hem 17 since The Humerly split in 1981, but left us to our own devices while continuing to manage the new version of the original band. Ian Craig Marsh had left BEF after the first Music of Quality and Distinction album a year ago. Still no idea why, so I was running my production career solo, which is a major leap of faith for me. I had come to this point on pure chutzpah and intuition. I was lucky enough to have a supportive group of friends and, of course, my family around me, but I was now getting into deeper and deeper water and had literally no idea how this would pan out. How far was I prepared to go to capitalize on this astounding turn of events? What if it meant abandoning my secure and familiar life in London, cocooned by love and familiarity? Could I hack it? Up to this point, I had always followed the principle of grabbing every emerging opportunity without hesitation, but I suspected that soon I would be inundated with offers of work, and I would have to choose carefully. I've never been a strategic thinker, just a hard-working doer with an appetite for risk. To this day, I have never made a business or life plan, just relied on gut instinct. Did I need a manager with experience of the big boys' world, of the international music business? I'd already heard stories about the nefarious shark stateside, and the thought of being out of my depth secretly terrified me. In a nutshell, could I deal with all this alone? Ah, fuck it, let's have a go. What could possibly go wrong? Many, many times over the 40 years of my professional musical career, I've been asked to consider writing my autobiography. Many, many times I've thought it through and decided I'm not interesting enough. What is it with me? Is it my upbringing in a poor household in post-war Sheffield? Is it my default suspicion that one day someone will discover that I've been blagging it all along? Or perhaps I like the mystery associated with keeping my personal details private and separate to the art project that seems to encapsulate my creative and professional life. Are there too many skeletons in the cupboard? Did I lock and board up the cupboard for a good reason? In a particularly lucid moment recently, I posted a tweet pretentiously stating that we are all gods in our own mythological universes. I like this, and what's more, I believe it's true. We all have our own version of something like the Marvel Cinematic Universe, featuring truths, half-truths, and downright fictions about our lives, our friends, lovers, acquaintances, and enemies. We all have our own heroes and villains, some real, some imaginary. Sometimes I feel like a minor deity in a workaday universe, overwhelmed by the other characters, gods, and their authority, but occasionally I rise up the hierarchy to the top table, and I feel a certain, probably unjustifiable, power of command over my own destiny. This happens rarely, but nowadays a bit more frequently as I finally get close to something approaching maturity. That's why, at last, I've decided I have enough of an idea of who I am and was, to write this autobiography. I want this book to feel as intimate and conversational as possible, while avoiding being too self-indulgent or smug. Quite a challenge for a post-war Sheffielder, always in fear of bragging too much in case people say, "Who the fuck does he think he is?" or "He's changed since he moved down to that London." Well, finally, I can honestly say I don't give a fuck what anyone thinks anymore. I'm proud about what I've achieved in my professional life, and I have few regrets about my personal life. And if I don't write this autobiography now, I probably never will. At the time of writing, we're all in the middle of a coronavirus lockdown, so I'll almost certainly never have this much undistracted free time ever again. And, more to the point, this process is keeping me sane. I started by organising the timeline of significant events on a spreadsheet with the help of my daughter Eleanor. After 2 weeks, this had expanded to a printout filling most of the wall of my study. It became apparent that to try to cram my life into one book was going to mean some severe restriction on the ramblings I had planned, so I made the decision to write this in two volumes. I liked the similarity with the artistic conceit used on the first British Electric Foundation album, Music of Quality and Distinction, Volume 1. Of course, at that time, I had no idea there would ever be a Volume 2, but it seemed ironically confident. I feel the same way about this first volume. And why the title Electronically Yours? I designed the artwork for the front cover of our first Human League single, Being Boiled, and at the time, I liked the idea of using a strapline or slogan that would humanise the product. I was already bored with the electronic music is so cold and emotionless brigade, so this phrase was part two fingers up to them and part an attempt to subtly imply that we could create a human connection using technology, hence the name The Human League. In this volume, I'll be covering my austere but loving upbringing in various council houses in Sheffield, my development through a state grammar school, which was a wannabe public school, and all the teenage fun, torment, and embarrassing first steps into adulthood and transgression. At that unique moment in time, Sheffield was a fertile breeding ground for a flavoursome version of creativity and free-spirited investigation, but with a bolshy, ironic wink. I was introduced to Meat Whistle, a council-funded arts performance youth club project which changed my life. It's where I met Glenn and Ian, my future bandmates, and a combination of white-hot experimentation and love of electronic music would lead to the creation of the Human League, British Electric Foundation, BEF, and Heaven 17, and beyond. This in turn led to an unexpectedly fruitful production career, working with some of the world's greatest singers. For those of you less familiar with my musical history, here's a little more detail. After my initial crazy experiments with proto-groups with my best mates, mainly for just one performance each, with names like Musical Vomit, Underpants, Dick Velcro and the Astronets, The Dead Daughters, and VDK and the Studs, the fact that Ian Craig Marsh and myself had somehow managed to get half-decent, relatively well-paid jobs as computer operators meant that we could afford to contemplate buying synthesizers on the Never Never. So that's what we did. Suddenly we had the means to create what was in our fevered imaginations. And when we sacked Addy Newton and recruited a new lead singer, my best friend from school, Phil Oakey, The Human League was born. Our first recording was a strange but interesting song called Being Boiled, reviewed in New Musical Express by Johnny Rotten in two words, fucking hippies. This was released on an independent label called Fast Records, which immediately caught the attention of the legendary John Peel, the primary influencer of the cool kids' national musical taste. Big word of mouth sales followed, and sure enough, the major labels and some minors came knocking. EMI, Virgin, Fiction, Island, and a few others, but our sights were set on the hottest, hippest label of the moment, Virgin Records. We were excited and overwhelmed by the idea of such national interest, but we were unprepared for the pace of our careers taking off. We were being carried along on the tsunami wave, which would later be known as New Wave. I'll reveal my hopes and fears, my astonishment at the variety of stuff I shoehorned myself into, and the overarching realization that everybody's bluffing their way to success, and that I could do it too. But looking back, some of it was not bullshit at all. Some of it was, of course. The journey so far has been a rollercoaster ride of epic proportions. Hold tight and join me. I'm approaching this book as a kind of travel writer of my interior thoughtscape. If it seems a little overly obsessed with my music career, that's because it is my life, a life that I'm eternally grateful for. As many of my musician friends ironically say, one day I'll wake up and I'll have to do a proper job. I've rejoiced in my passion being my proper job for over 40 years, and that is something I'll never take for granted. Imagine that, making music and helping others make theirs. I should be paying them. So let's start this journey. 1956 to 1970, growing up in Sheffield. When I was very young, I realised. During the research and preparation I did before starting to write this book, I realised I had only a sketchy knowledge of my family's provenance. It's not that it doesn't interest me, it's just that all my life I've spent doing stuff, not really considering the effect or consequences, regarding the past as irrelevant to my hunger to reach some indefinable future. Also, there's a kind of built-in self-effacement in Sheffield folk, as though merely acknowledging that you have an interesting family isn't for the likes of us. It's not really got anything to do with cap-doffing to the classes above, well, I hope not, but it's more about an unspoken acceptance that there's nothing particularly interesting about an average, poorish, working-class family. A bit of a chip on the shoulder, I suppose, but not uncommon in our world. Well, in the process of getting my ducks in a row, I became kind of curious, so I foolishly asked my somewhat obsessive wife, Lansley, to help me trace a few interesting characters from my family tree. She'd recently started the process as part of the necessary research to prove my Irish heritage, to enable me to get an Irish passport in the wake of all the ludicrous Brexit bullshit. She's Irish, by the way. A ramble through a few generations of my lineage on my mother's side, the Edleys, revealed a mixture of steelworkers, tailors, soldiers and farmers, mainly from Sheffield, Essex, Birmingham and the US, whereas Dad's line is an assortment of steelworkers, soldiers, labourers, shoemakers and domestic staff, born in a wide range of areas from Sheffield to Somerset and Belfast, Bath, Waterford and even India. Then I asked Lansley if she could dig a little more to find some funny or curious earlier ancestors. Maybe you could go back as far as, I don't know, 1700s, I casually threw in. This was probably a mistake, as it became a two-week-long continuous series of astonished exclamations and news bulletins delivered with increasing regularity, often in the middle of the night, as she delved deeper and deeper into my bloodline. She burst into the bedroom one night and whispered in my ear, "Charlemagne," which completely freaked me out. Here is a minuscule fraction of the incredible and insane detail that she has revealed. The characters discovered make TV's Who Do You Think You Are look like a badly researched piece of boring tat. So, I command you to kneel and pay homage to some of my ancestors. We'll start working backwards from the 1600s. Andrew Warner, 10th great-grandfather, 1595 to 1648. Plymouth Puritan, one of the earliest settlers in America. Amazing. Robert Lestrange, Lord of Rocwardine, 22nd great-grandfather, 1267 to 1324. Knight! Ralph d'Aubigny, 25th great-grandfather, 1134 to 91. Crusader killed at the Battle of Acre, or Acre. Princess de Bourgogne d'Ardenne, 32nd great-grandmother, born 872. That explains my love of their pate. Ragnhildr Hrólfsdóttir, 35th great-grandmother, 825 to 92. In Orkney saga legend, the warrior mother of Rollo. Rothaid de Bobbio, No, really, I'm not making these names up. 38th great-grandmother, 820 to 58, Italian noblewoman. Einstein Arvesen Glumre the Noisy, my favourite name, possibly ever. 36th great-grandfather, 810 to 70, Viking warrior. Bernard, Prince of Denmark, 31st great-grandfather, 880 to 955, Prince. One particularly bizarre discovery was my 8th great-grandfather, John Carrington. For unknown reasons, he was charged with witchcraft at a court held on 20th of February, 1651 in Connecticut. He was the first man to be convicted and executed for witchcraft in New England. The indictment read, "Thou art indicted by the name of John Carrington of Wethersfield, carpenter, that not having the fear of God before thine eyes, thou hast entertained familiarity with Satan, the great enemy of God and mankind, and by his help has done works above the course of nature, according to the laws of God and the established laws of this commonwealth, thou deservest to die." Cool provenance, don't you agree? Now we're getting to the good stuff. You'll love these. Saint Itta de Nivelle, 44th great-grandmother, 592 to 652. I'm descended from a saint, motherfucker! Charles Martel, 41st great-grandfather, 676 to 741, from Liège, mayor of the palace, effectively ruled as a king of Francia, France, and grandfather of Charlemagne, emperor of the Romans. What a dude! Carrie Wind Fornjotsen, 45th great-grandfather, 189 to 240, king of Kvenland, wherever that is or was. Gaius Julius Severus, 65th great-grandfather, 25 to 80 AD, tribune of Legio the VI, Frata, Rome. Adabogiona, 68th great-grandmother, 90 to 50 BCE, Celtic princess. And finally, Attalus, 72nd great-grandfather, 269 to 197 BCE, king of Pergamon, Izmir, Turkey. Ptolemy, 77th great-uncle, 376 to 334 BCE, Alexander the Great's right-hand man. Check it out. Impressive stuff, eh? Or just plain nuts? Something to chat about over a pint at least. Thanks again to my crazy wife. Love you, but I'm not really sure what to think. I had no idea I was the progeny of kings, princes, saints and witches, nor did anyone else. I was just a working class lad from an industrial town in the north, and that's what most journalists wanted to talk about. Is there something in the water up there? If I had a pound for every time a journalist had asked this question, I'd be, well, at least £50 richer. Sheffield is an unusual city, often called Britain's biggest village because of its friendly inhabitants. It has a population of about 550,000, and it was a massive northern industrial powerhouse before the term had been appropriated by politicians, and a centre of steel and cutlery production since, believe it or not, the 14th century. It was world famous for the steel products created there. I still look at cutlery for the Made in Sheffield mark wherever I visit in the world. Then the 1970s arrived, and a combination of factors, including the 1973 oil crisis and ultimately the rise of Margaret Thatcher, made sure the main steel employers in town lost a total of around 60,000 jobs that decade. It was a massive shock to the people of Sheffield. But growing up in Sheffield wasn't all bad news. My memories were almost all happy ones from my childhood, despite our privations. We simply knew no different. My parents, Jack and Kitty, were from solid working-class trade union roots. My mum was a seamstress and then full-time mother, and my dad was a proud toolmaker who worked at Joseph Thompson's on Townhead Street in Sheffield city centre for almost 50 years, retiring early through ill health, partly caused by smoking 80 Capstan full-strength unfiltered fags a day for most of his life. He did relent eventually, at the age of 80, by moving to filter-tipped, but after a few weeks he started breaking the tips off. the perpetually circulating ground steel dust in the air in his awful, dangerous factory space didn't help either. He once took me to his workplace when he deemed me old enough. I was about 12, and I will never forget the hell-like conditions he had to endure every day of his working life. I couldn't wait to get out at the end of the visit, and I strongly believe, although he never admitted it, that he took me there to ensure that I never, ever made the same mistake as he did. In the Second World War, he was also an air raid warden, a job that he was proud of, but he never talked about the details. He ARP'd at night, fitting this around working full-time during the day. Sheffield was heavily bombed in the war due to armaments manufacturing, so part of his job was not only warning of a forthcoming air raid and getting people into their shelters, but also sounding the all clear and searching the destroyed buildings and rubble for survivors. I was told later by some of my extended family that this was not the insignificant job that my dad played down, but a highly dangerous and even traumatic one, having to cope regularly with finding buried victims of the air raids. There were also rumblings that he was admitted to Whiteley Woods Mental Hospital in Sheffield after the war, possibly with PTSD. He did confess to me later that his main ambition in life was to get a job in an office, as he proudly told me he'd passed a series of exams to receive a merit certificate. This was apparently quite something in the 1930s, but, as fate would have it, the only jobs available during the Great Depression in Sheffield were either steelworker or toolmaker, and toolmaker was deemed to be the more technically challenging, so the smarter kids were placed in those roles. His fate was sealed from that moment. He never escaped to the promised land of paperwork and typewriters. This was one of his life's biggest regrets. He would work 50 hours a week plus overtime in grim conditions, so the only time we had to spend together was Sundays, when he loved to take me to the local park, buy me a Vimto, what a luxury, or even a bottle of Coca-Cola. Now that was a treat. I treasured those Sundays. Dad would give us a small amount of money to go and fetch him and the family some chocolate on Sunday afternoon. Mars bars were a favourite, and Bounty. We'd bring a couple of bars back, and he'd carefully divide them into slices, like the precious commodities we were convinced they were at the time. One Sunday, I must have been 6 years old, we were returning from the shop, myself and my sister Janet, who is 10 years older than me, when I carelessly ran into the main road without looking, and was instantly hit by a Ford Prefect car. As I lay on the ground, dazed, the driver picked me up, horrified, and shouted at Janet, "Where do you live?" She replied, "Just down the road on Hope Street." They rushed me home, and my main memories were two things. One, that I could feel warm liquid running down my leg, and I was terrified it was blood. Fortunately, the shock had caused me to wee, but it was scarily embarrassing. The other thought was, have I broken anything? I cried and begged the distraught driver, "I don't want to go to hospital, please!" Once we were home, our family doctor was summoned. We had no telephone, so we had to borrow a neighbour's, and he arrived post-haste. After a quick examination by my weeping mother, solemn dad, and the doctor himself, it seemed that I was only bruised. As I was explaining how happy I was not to be carted off in an ambulance, the driver interjected, "Bloody good job I had the brakes repaired yesterday, or your lad might have been a goner." I still haven't been admitted to hospital since then. Life is risky enough, thanks. In those days, children spent 90% of their time with their mother, and it's fair to say I absolutely loved my mum Kitty. She was the domestic rock of the family, cooking, cleaning, shopping, cuddling, bathing. We had no bathroom, only an outside toilet and a tin bath, and in return she adored me and all my siblings. As I was growing up, my parents would argue a lot, nearly always about money, of which there was little. I listened at the top of the stairs to one of their arguments, where she threatened to walk out on my dad. As a six-year-old, I thought it was really going to happen, so I became clingier and clingier to her until I confessed I'd heard the argument. "Don't be silly, I'd never leave you," she cooed, but I'm convinced it made me insecure in my relationships for decades to come. No doubt it had a big effect on me. Yep, My family's lack of money was always a real and present problem, although at the time my parents never used to complain, except to each other. There were hardly any cars on our street, so football on the cobbles, yes, at that time, all the side streets were cobbled, was a big part of our lives, especially on Sunday afternoons in the summer, when the entire street would take part in a 30-a-side game with kids, dads, mums, brothers, aunts, dogs, sisters, grandmas, uncles, brothers, cats, granddads, toddlers, all taking part. It was a kind of working-class version of the Eton Wall game, but much gentler and more fun. Those were among the happiest times of my early years. It was not uncommon for the family's cash to run out midweek, no savings, of course, and Mum had to apologise for a less-than-gourmet vegetable soup or just chips and fish fingers. But for the most part, her cooking was fantastic, if basic. Favourites included meat and potato pie, drowned in the ultimate Sheffield condiment, Henderson's relish, a Worcestershire sauce, a bit like Liam Perrin's but sweeter, corned beef hash, an OXO cube-based thin but tasty stew with veg, slow-braised brisket of beef with veg, one of the cheapest cuts, very trendy now, of course. Friday was fish and chips day, always cod. Saturday was always tuna sandwiches for tea, and Sunday was either a roast beef dinner, or if we were splashing out, roast chicken. Still a treat in those days, chicken was relatively expensive. Dad's weekly treat was several pints of Ward's Best Bitter on Saturday night at St Philip's Working Men's Club on Western Street. This place was the heart and soul of his and fellow workers' fun time. Usually featuring an incredibly loud cover version rock group, Smoke on the Water was a particular favourite, a tombola, a drummer, and organist, almost always called something like Frank and Ernest, an MC, give order please, thank you please, vainly trying to get the attention of the raucous crowd who had been partially deafened by the aforementioned rock group's ear-splitting rendition of Yellow River or some such current hit. You just knew they'd rather be playing Black Sabbath or Wishbone Ash. Understated, it was not. Our council house at 33 Hope Street had four rooms, two bedrooms, a kitchen, and a front room with a small rented TV and a sofa. My sisters, Maureen and Janet, slept in the smaller bedroom. Mum, Dad, and my brother Steve and I all slept in one cramped bedroom. This also had a potty under the bed. No one went to the outside toilet at night, especially in winter, so our bedroom constantly reeked of piss. I just thought this was normal. The rooms downstairs, however, were completely covered with nicotine stains and therefore stank even more. We must have gone to school stinking of fags, but as it was omnipresent at home, we just assumed everyone's house was suffused with the same aroma. Of course, there was no central heating. The house was warmed only by a coal fire stroke cooking range in the kitchen, and, if Dad had worked some overtime that week, a fire in the front room. The bedrooms were absolutely freezing in winter, so water bottles were necessary to avoid hypothermia, but it was our home. One of my earliest memories of hot summer evenings in Hope Street was lying in bed with the windows open, listening to the distant sound of the drop forges travelling down the valleys from Attercliffe. Kaboom, kaboom. It sounded like a giant's heartbeat, which was so reassuring that it lulled me to sleep. Maybe my love of this music concrète led to my predilection for found sound and industrial noise in my future career. All I know is that the sounds and smells of industry were everywhere in the centre of Sheffield. I never gave it a second thought at the time. I assumed that all cities sounded like that. At home, we only had six books, all subject-based volumes of Encyclopaedia Britannica, science, history, geography, physics, biology, and the Commonwealth. My parents must have gone into hock to buy these on the Never Never, and indeed, almost all of our clothes were bought on credit. Every Whitsuntide, we would get a brand new set of clothes, and the tradition was to go around all the neighbours' houses, knocking and pleading when the door opened. Do you like my new clothes? At which point they would give you what they could afford. A working class tradition showing financial solidarity in a really cute and society-gluing way. Playing out was our main recreation, but this depended on there being no rain at all. One of my strongest memories from that time was begging my mum to let me play football outside. She would always reply, "If them roof slates are wet, then you're not going out." I would stare longingly out of the window, willing the sun to come out or the wind to dry up the slates so that I could play with my mates, mainly because there was bugger all to do indoors. As I reached 7 or 8 years old, I became more friendly with the girls in our street and less interested in wandering off with the gang. I've always been a bit of an outsider and I still don't like that gang mentality. Although I'm not sure how that fits with my love of football, but anyway, if I was stuck inside, I would have to resort to our 6 books. I must have read these all, cover to cover, at least 10 times each. My favourites were biology and physics, and the one I most struggled with was the Commonwealth. I still do. My parents died in the late 1990s. Mum died first of breast cancer, Dad followed within a year of being diagnosed with lung cancer. I remember him saying near the end as I held his hand, "Martin, I'm going home. I'm going home," in a thick Sheffield accent. "I want to see Kit." Of course I said, "Don't be daft, Dad. You got loads to live for," but he really didn't, and he died within a week. I was heartbroken, and for the first time I felt I understood what it meant to be an orphan. My father's pride and joy was the gold Omega watch he received for 50 years' service at work, which was worth a lot of money in those days, and it was certainly the most expensive thing he ever possessed. Even then, later he would say in an embittered way, 50 bloody years and all I got was a bloody watch. His main gripe was that he received very little superannuation, workplace pension, because he had to retire 3 years early due to ill health. The Union 40's case, but he only received about £1,000 instead of the £10,000 or more he would have received had he retired at 60. This resentment troubled him until the end of his days. When he died, the only thing I wanted were the 6 Encyclopedia Britannica books, which were my constant childhood companions, and a beautiful engraved carriage clock I had bought them for their 60th wedding anniversary. My mother never had any money of her own to leave, but we were always loved and looked after well, and never went without food or clothing. I miss them so much. I'm very grateful to have had them in my life. I think about them almost every day. They were the kindest, most gentle and stoic people, which I now appreciate as a rare thing. I was an accident, the result of an August bank holiday drunken moment, I suspect. I was born on the 19th of May 1956, 6 weeks premature at the Jessop Hospital in Sheffield. My father was 50, my mother was 44, unusually old parents for that time, but it seems that I was treasured by all my family, especially my 2 sisters, Maureen and Janet, who were 20 and 10 when I was born. I was their new toy, and of course, I became my brother Stephen's football pal. He was 8 when I was born. Ah, football. Sheffield Wednesday were, and still are, our family's love. In the absence of any God-fearing interest in religion, it was very much like the kind of quasi-religious devotion present in Liverpool's football obsession and culture. My dad used to say there were 2 football teams in Sheffield, Sheffield Wednesday, the Owls, and Sheffield Wednesday Reserves. He'd scowl at the mere mention of Sheffield United, the Blades. In fact, all talk of SUFC was banned in his company. He even wouldn't eat streaky bacon as it matched SUFC's strip of red and white stripes. My grandfather Richard lived nearby, and we would visit him every Sunday. He'd give me a big, beardy, bristly, smoky kiss and a handful of Murray mints, which I never liked, but I couldn't break it to him. Longevity seemed to run in my father's side of the family. My grandfather was born around the time of forming SWFC in 1867, so all generations of the Ware family were solid Wednesdayites since the start. The alternative was never an option. My first ever home game was by far the best game I've ever seen in the flesh. 31st of August 1968, Sheffield Wednesday 5, Manchester United 4. Wednesday were 4-2 down and came back to win against all odds in front of a crowd of 54,000. I was on the Spy and Cop with my sister's then-boyfriend Jeff. They're still married now. United's team featured a panoply of superstars. Best, Law, Styles, Charlton, Stepney, Kidd, Morgan. A young lad called Jack Whittam scored a hat-trick for the Owls that day. I was bewitched and I was doomed. Wednesday will always be an important part of my life. I still have 2 season tickets, even though I live in London. I helped to start the original SWFC Supporters Trust, now known as Wednesdayite, and if I were a lot richer, I would have loved to have been involved at board level with the club. I've also released 2 singles for the club under the pseudonym of the Hillsborough Crew, the first of which was co-written by Ian Reddington. 1986's Steel City Move On Up, written for the FA Cup semi-final game against Everton, which of course we lost. Kudos to Virgin Records for letting us release it though, especially as they managed to manufacture a fake news story in the Daily Mirror proudly stating that he had sold 500,000 copies on the week of release, more like 5,000 and all in Sheffield. Don't believe the hype, kids. Then there was the official 1993 Sheffield Wednesday Cup single, If It's Wednesday, It Must Be Wembley, this time by the Hillsborough Crew, subtle difference, in anticipation of winning at least one of the 2 major cups in 1993. The title was inspired by the 1969 cult comedy film, If It's Tuesday, This Must Be Belgium. Our record featured an audacious vinyl picture disc of the whole SWFC squad in traditional centre-of-the-pitch 3-row pose, but wearing Ray-Bans a la the Blues Brothers, and with Ian and me in the centre of the photo, dressed as goalkeepers, no Ray-Bans. My biggest thrill associated with this was a contract signed with the SWFC Players Pool, an ad hoc joint venture organised by the players to pool all commercial gains from the cup runs. The organiser was my hero, Chris Waddle, who had just been voted Football Writers Player of the Year and was having the most incredible season. As is par for the course for the life of a Wednesdayite, we lost both cup finals in the most painful way possible. Typically, the FA Cup was thrown away in the last minute of extra time, Chris Wood's take a bow, in a tightly fought replay. We used to paraphrase the famous saying, you draw some, you lose some. These vinyl records neatly exemplify my life of joy and suffering as a Wednesdayite, the pain of which appears to be on course to continue until the day of my demise, and on through the generations via my son Gabriel, whom I indoctrinated at an early age. His first home game at the age of 6 was a 5-0 loss to Norwich, which proved to be an eerily prescient pre-echo of our future misery. Recently, Gabe said to me, do you realise, Dad, that I've never ever seen us win anything? Plus ça change, as they say, but not in Sheffield. However, up the Owls, Wednesday till I die, we're all Wednesday, aren't we? Etc, etc, repeat until fade. We shall undercome. One day in 1969, my dad called me into the front room, and in hushed tones he said, Martin, I want you to have this. My father gave it to me, and now I'm passing it on to you. He handed me a scruffy-looking hardback book covered in aged brown paper. On the cover there was the handwritten title, The Romance of the Wednesday by Richard Sparling, the definitive history of Sheffield Wednesday FC from 1867 to 1926. This, I found out later, was informally called the Wednesdayites' Bible by the faithful. I was so touched. He had so few private possessions, and he could see that I loved Wednesday as much as he and his father did. This really meant a lot to him and to me. I shall pass this book on to my son Gabriel, and so on and so on. Cultural history is so important. As I grew up in a love-filled but very financially challenged environment, I became curious about the world around me, which in our confined 2-up, 2-down house largely meant our Dansette record player and stacks of vinyl. These were bought by Maureen and Janet, who were both massive pop fans in the 60s, and I literally spent hours and hours playing and replaying the increasingly crackly singles and occasional LP stacking up to 6 of them on the spindle to watch the magic of the automatic drop of each single in turn. Imagine no mixtapes, no recording off the radio, nothing except the same playlist in a different order time after time. But I loved it. It was my favourite toy. A little later, I was given for my birthday a treasured transistor radio, which in timeless, cliched but nevertheless true fashion, I used to sneak into my bed and listen to. This was incredibly exciting, and I would avidly consume all the latest music and even the DJ patter, Emperor Roscoe, Kid Jensen, etc., from the semi-forbidden and daring pirate station Radio Luxembourg. This was the engine driving my personal taste in music, and therefore my growing sense of identity, as opposed to aping my sister's tastes. Music completely defined who I was at that time. Radio Luxembourg played all the best Motown and pop classics from that golden age, and I have particularly strong memories of Good Vibrations by the Beach Boys, Reflections by the Supremes, Bernadette by the Four Tops, Green Tambourine by the Lemon Pipers, You Keep Me Hanging On by the Supremes again, Patches by Clarence Carter, Sandy Shaw, who I later worked with, the incomparable Dusty Springfield, Gene Pitney, etc., etc., etc. All drifting and filtering in and out of audibility, riding on the charismatic and mysterious oscillations at the end of the medium wave band, Fabulous 208. I became deeply emotionally connected to the stories of the songs and the soundscapes, well, as much as my childish mind could comprehend, and I'm sure this gave me an unusual perspective on my professional songwriting later. I was also very enamoured of my sister's collection of soundtrack albums, including West Side Story, South Pacific, The Sound of Music, together with a large collection of Anthony Newley albums and singles. Idle on Parade springs to mind, and, unfortunately, Cliff Richard. In fact, Summer Holiday was the first film I saw in the cinema, closely followed by Those Magnificent Men in Their Flying Machines. I was utterly mesmerised by the sheer glamour and scale of the big screen at the Odeon. It's hard to imagine a world with only 2 TV channels in black and white, and then suddenly to be thrust into a beautiful, alien universe of colour. I'm still head over heels in love with big screen cinema. Let's hope it survives the digital age. Every year, people at my dad's workplace would save up for the big night out at Christmas. The pantomime at the Lyceum Theatre. Magical colours, shouty camp men dressed as women, mysterious transitions, women dressed as boys, live music, free sweeties thrown into the audience, living in mortal fear of being dragged from our seats to be humiliated on stage. It's all reminiscent of one of our Heaven 17 concerts. I think it's safe to say that pantomime was responsible for my love of theatre. To be honest, I felt my life at home was as rich and interesting as I could imagine. I suppose ignorance is bliss, but genuinely, we seem to be happy with our lot in life. I suspect that my mum and dad hid the worst effects of our privations in their typically selfless and stoic manner. Later, when I reached adulthood, I could never understand the constant moaning about people's family situations, arguments, grudges, resentments, and all that seems to be part of a normal family's life. I can only praise my remarkable parents and siblings for giving all of us the most emotionally secure and loving upbringing in some of the most difficult circumstances imaginable. 1966-70, First Loves. With concentration, my size increased. I was bullied at school. Nothing unusual about that, but to be bullied multiple times by several different and unconnected groups of people makes me feel there may have been some kind of pattern. I was a quiet, shy and studious kid who really didn't care for gangs or boy stuff. And when I wasn't playing football with my friends, I was much happier hanging with the girls in our street. I found them fascinating. What made them tick? Why did they smell so nice compared to boys? Why did they talk incessantly and make up kissing games and gabble about emotions? None of my male friends ever talked about such stuff. I was a gentle, sensitive boy who had been nurtured in a loving way by my parents and in particular my older sisters and my mother, and I just felt I was totally normal. I was wrong. The bullying started in the final year of junior school when we had moved to Burngreave, a rough part of Sheffield, with an even rougher school called Piebank Junior School. I was the new kid in class, and in those days, they used to seat you in the classroom according to your ranking in various tests, a bit like a living league table. As I was very good at maths, and science in particular, I was soon ranked number one in the class, sat next to my first love, Judith, who was number two. We quickly became close, and I dreaded every test that would come along in case my ranking dropped and we could no longer sit together. This fortunately never happened, as the rest of our class were mainly disengaged dummies who tried their hardest to disrupt any attempt at learning. No wonder they hated me, and they were all boys. Regularly, I would be confronted in the playground, asked for pocket money, and when I refused, punched, kicked, Chinese burned, taunted. You know, the usual, we'll get you after school stuff. I lived in nervous anticipation of breaks and after school walks home. This continued until a new family called the Sonettis, name changed, moved into our block of council flats, on the floor directly above us. I know they sound like something out of The Sopranos, but in reality, they were a poor Italian family of six with twin boys who joined my class at school. They had absolutely no intention of taking part in any sensible way in class and made it their mission to disrupt everything, usually to the point of temporary exclusion. Fortunately, they attended intermittently, but when they did, it was chaos. One day, they followed me home from school, taunting me in broken English. My pace quickened in an attempt to lose them, but as I finally reached home and thought I was safe, one of the twins pinned me against the concrete wall inside the stairway of the flats, away from public view. "Give me your money," a Sonetti twin snarled. "I don't have any," I pleaded pathetically. Then they both attacked me without warning, punching me in the stomach and then, as I was lying on the floor, kicking me in the face. This was no Chinese burn. They ran off upstairs to their apartment, but not before warning me not to tell anyone. This was going to be a challenge, as I was in an obviously beaten-up state, with a rapidly developing black eye and severe bruising on my body. In a state of shock, I tried to compose myself before entering my house. "What's happened to you, love?" my horrified mother gasped. I must have looked quite a disturbing sight. I fell down the stairs and banged my head, Mum." "Tell us what really happened, darling." I burst into tears and told her the whole story. Not just this violent act, but the months of torture I'd been suffering. "Right, I'm calling the coppers," growled Kitty. My mum was a gentle sort, and her compassion was legendary, but nobody messed with her son. I begged her not to, as I feared this would lead to more beatings, but she was right, this had to stop, and the only way was to stand up to the bullies. She called my dad at work. We still didn't have a phone, so this was only for emergencies, and he came home early to deal with the crisis. Both my mum and dad strode up the stairs to the Sonetti's apartment and read them the riot act. Of course, the twins denied it, and their parents refused to believe it at first, so they brought me to the front door and showed them my battered face. I was never bullied from that day onwards by the Sonettis, and the police threatened to take the twins to court. A few months later, they were thrown out of their flat for rent arrears, and we never saw them again. There were various other examples of bullying throughout my early teenage years, but this was much more standard stuff, none of which I gave in to. One thing I'd learnt from the Sonetti incidents was that giving in created more and more threat, not less, so best to be brave and face up to your tormentors. But why did I attract bullies? I wasn't rich or big-headed. I was always friendly to people. I didn't make myself a target in any way. I was popular, as I was pretty good at football. To this day, I don't really understand why, except there are many abused and disturbed children from dysfunctional families who are restaging their own conflicts in an attempt to gain control of their own lives. I had a happy upbringing, and this vibe must have wound up kids who had little love, or worse, suffered abuse at home. Maybe it was also because I was regarded as a teacher's pet, as I was always top of the class, partly motivated by my desire to keep my seat next to Judith. My crush on Judith had been encouraged by the music teacher, who started a handbell ringing group and asked me if I'd like to join the all-girl ensemble. Great, I thought. More time with Judith. More time with girls. Hold on. I'll be picked on for this. More bullying, I suppose. Oh well, let's do it anyway. Although I'd played recorder and sang with the school choir at my previous school, this required some discipline and rudimentary music score reading, but anything to be with my secretly beloved Judith. One particular practice featured 16 bells and 4 players including myself, which was quite challenging. I overheard Judith and the other 2 girls discussing the size of the bells they each had. "But Judith has the biggest bell," as I interjected. This caused enormous hilarity, as it transpired that they were discussing the size of their newly arriving breasts. I was mortified. As we arrived back at school for the final term, I couldn't wait to get to my favourite desk to see Judith. "We're going to rearrange the desks a little for this term," the teacher announced. "Judith has left the school with her family to move to Nottingham." Oh no, cruel fate. For the first time in my life, I was truly heartbroken. I would never meet another girl like her. Oh, woe is me, etc. This proved not to be the case, but nevertheless, it feels like the end of the world when you're 11 years old. I'm sure this cameo is...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.